Hello and welcome to the Long Ball Street podcast. Today I'm joined by James once again. He's filling in for Matt, who's still away on paternity leave. Remember, if you'd rather watch this than listen to it, we're on the Long Ball Street YouTube channel, youtube.com/TheLongBallStreet. But more importantly, we're joined by one Paul Canaville, ex-Chelsea, Reading, my bad. And before, your story is incredible, Paul. People that do know it will know that already. And I've been looking into it a lot over the last couple of weeks. And it kind of really blew me away, everything that you've lived through. But before going through that, we thought a good way to start this, didn't we, Jim? Would be to talk about what you've learned. If you was just to give a lesson or to give a message to your 16-year-old self, knowing everything that you do, what would you say?
To, if I'm going back, to be honest, it's to listen to my parents. They knew exactly the devices, what a kid would be doing, what would they be getting up to.
Yeah.
And they knew exactly. And I obviously didn't. And wayward, from age of 12, I've got to say, I started going astray. And it's just to, you understand and take time and listen to them. Inner yourself, to believe in yourself. And sometimes that's the factor with us kids. We don't believe in ourselves and we don't get encouraged more. And I wasn't encouraged at all. I didn't have that background of encouragement. It was always somebody else, but it wasn't somebody else I wanted to hear it from. I wanted to hear it from my parents.
Yeah.
So at times it was, yeah, rudely on the street, kind of followed. I was like the lamb. I wasn't a bad boy, but I wanted to be the bad boy.
What sort of things was you getting up to at 12?
Come on, man. He's trying to, little robberies and little, you know, going in shops. I wasn't a good thief. I was so bad. I was watching that kids and they're like, what are you doing? And you know how it was when your kid is nicking sweets.
Yeah.
And I went in there and I thought, yeah, and I took my Twix and I thought, I slipped it in my pocket and I thought,
good
yeah. And I'm making out like, oh yeah, buy the chewing gum and go to straight to the counter. And I'm there taking out the money, paying for it. And he said, yeah, what about the Twix? And I was so embarrassed. I said, I can't even nick a Twix. So, you know what I mean? I went, nah, Paul, you're not a thief. Don't do that. It's not happening.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was just, for me, yeah, believing in yourself as a youngster and getting encouragement and support, I think is what a lot of kids, when I say West Indian kids back then, did lack. We didn't get that. And my mum would tell you straight, she wasn't supportive. She wasn't motherly as such. And I kind of, yeah.
What advice would you give someone who isn't getting that encouragement and support, but is a 13-year-old kid? If they can't find it in their parents, depending on, I guess, their living situation, then what?
Find someone who you're friend with and open up, talk with them, because that's what I didn't do. That was because of my parents, once again, that was my mum, should I say. It was a case of your business, anything to do with your business stayed in the four walls in your house. And it was like, sometimes there's a lot of things that was on my mind that I wanted to share and I wanted to open up. And it wasn't just with my mum, it was outside of that. And so when somebody saw me and they could see that something was wrong, they would ask, you all right, Paul? And I would say, yeah. But I was in denial, I wasn't. I wanted to open up, but because I was scared of my mum, if I told them, then my mum here, then I'm in trouble. And so yeah, a lot, that kind of built up on my shoulder. It was really a lot of weight. And I don't get me wrong, it was like going in my room because my sister and my mum shared one bed and I had my own bed and was like, I was a loner. I was just looking at the four walls and I wanted to open up, wanted to talk to somebody and I didn't have an older brother that I could share that with.
Yeah. So it was your mum, wasn't she? She was working a lot.
Yeah, man, don't get me wrong. That was hard and I realise that now because I was a youngster and I just wanted everything. Like as a kid does, and when you see something, you want it because you always see your friend get it. Why can't I get it? And you kind of envy that. So my mum, trust me, she was working some shifts, and it was difficult for a young black girl. I'm going to be honest, it was really difficult. She came over in the late 50s, and 16 years old, and to find work, it was hard enough. And the stories she used to give me, I was like, wow. I understand things have changed now, but I don't think I could have took that. What she was taking at that time.
What do you mean by that?
Oh, the racism. I mean, refused jobs just because of the colour of her skin. Worked in the hotel, she worked downstairs in laundry, then she got promoted, she went for the promotion to be a maid, and when she asked the manager said, no, the position's gone. But the same white woman that worked with her went for the position and got it. And that choked my mum up. She said, yeah, well, fuck your work, fuck your job. Oh, my swearing.
Yeah, no, it's good, it's good. Yeah, it's not as good. I just think people have to censor themselves. They need not getting a general reflection of how they want to express themselves. Yeah, so feel free. Hmm. It's a shame, actually, because the colour of your skin seems to have defined a lot, certainly professionally, about your life. And even after the football, you know, because... You know, a lot of what you talk about, the reason why you're here now, I mean, you wouldn't be sitting here if you was a white guy. Do you know what I mean? Because, the reason why I'm saying that is because, you know, what's the story at Chelsea?
Exactly. It was hard. You've got to understand, it was, as a youngster, as a teenager, we're talking about 15, I was kind of unruly. I was difficult. I didn't know where I was going. I knew I wanted to play football. I knew I wanted to be a professional footballer, but I just saw it wasn't happening, so I just went wild. And I think what made it change is when I went into Borstal. And that was just something silly that I went, there's only one. There's always one. There's always one.
So
I got caught.
You can't turn it off either.
And you not.
Don't worry about that. That's all right.
That's my family. I bought him on the day out and look what he does.
So you went to Borstal
and yeah, for a silly little
That's
crime.
Terrifying though, right?
It is a 15-year-old locked up.
What's that moment like when there's
when you go down, you're in your room,
I
was 15, or 15, I was in the kind of dormitory kind of when you first go in with a lot of people, it was obviously to help me out, but it was watch an eye opener. I was like, all right, get up in the morning. All right, what's happening? Flop out. So you flop out what? Get washed in them. So I thought, okay. And you're in just your pants, or should I say, in a vest. And they've got you waiting out in the courtyard. And it was cold. So I said, how can they be, are you mad? No. So I saw this queue and I was like, well, I ain't going in no queue. So I walked straight into the bathing areas. The screw asked me, and they said, what are you doing? I said, what do you think I'm doing? I'm going to get washed. There's a queue. What queue? I was being arrogant. And I went in there giving it lip. He said, yep, you're down in the block. Bam. And from your down in the block, that put downstairs, you in the cell, that's another 3 days on to your normal.
Oh, fuck. Did you wear it out then?
No, I didn't know. Well, I'd soon find out. I'll tell you that. And I was like, what? So anyway, from I came out of the block upstairs, it was like, you know what, Paul? This is routine now. You got to listen, because now I'm used to my freedom. Don't get me wrong, nobody's telling me nothing, but this now, I'm in control. I'm not in control. So screws are telling you when you're getting up in the morning, you're flopping out, you fold your bed. Trust me, I couldn't believe the way I was making up my bed. It was like one of them soldiers. I mean, fine corners of folding your bed. I've never folded my bed like that before, but I soon knew how. And then folding your clothes, jumper. I didn't know they could fold and that slim. Mm. It was like in a compartment, and I was doing that every day. I learned to do that. And that kind of routine gets to be like an independent, because then you're starting to look after yourself.
Yeah.
So from there, yeah, I started following routines, and it was kind of not an open Borstal. Don't get me wrong, it wasn't really cages or something. During that week, I think I joined in the football team down there, and that was a good thing. And there was a lot of black boys and white boys in there from East London, North London. It was all good. And I went in the team, and it was funny enough that we played teams that came from outside, big men that came from outside, that was allowed in to the dorm, you know what I mean? So it was a case of, the screws were on one end, and there we are with the outside Wilson. Yeah, mate, you got a fag. Yeah, just secretly put it to the side. You know what I mean? Don't make it on. Yeah. So you think you can, you know, secretly get away with that and smoke you later. No, those screws had the living eagle eyes, man. They could see everything. So we were on site, played the team, and it's funny, we I think we won 10-0 and I scored 9 goals. It was unbelievable. But what stayed in my head was when one of the screws said to me, "You're good." He said, "Why don't you go for trials for Chelsea?" Now, I didn't know about Chelsea, to be honest. Mm. At a time, which everybody knows now, I used to support Leeds United. And yeah, now I know the history with Chelsea and Leeds. It's kind of, yeah. But it was like, not taking that serious. And when he said it, it was just, yeah, blind. But for me, you know what? I just wanted to get out of this ball store. Mm. And for me to get out of that ball store, it was a case of, I'm taking my career, so I want to be a footballer. I'm going to take this serious. That's the only thing at the time I felt I was good at. And so it was coming out, going back to me mum's and behaving and seeking work and just...
Was you always good at football? Was you always naturally gifted or did you have school teachers that trained you up or was it just something you were good at?
Funny when you say that because, yeah, it was just natural. I learned from nobody. I did my own thing. All I want, I loved training back in the day. It was always... Today's standard has changed, obviously, because back then when I was playing like 2-3 games a day. And it was like from my junior, then I played for the oldest kids, and I played for... And it was like, felt nothing about it. That's your kind of legs and you felt tired, but boy, the energy I had. Yeah. But today's football, you couldn't do that. You know what I mean?
Experiencing a place like that, was that something that then... And then getting that little nugget of encouragement from someone... Being in that moment, did that sort of provide that little snapshot to see that if I want to make something of myself, you're looking to latch onto something, and football was that thing for you?
It was. When you said encouragement, because it was great hearing it from the screws at the time when I was in the ball. But you know what? The inmates that were there, they were there because they were telling me, "Cannon boy, you're good. You know, you don't know. You should go for it." And I was like, "Yeah." And you know what I mean? Everybody kept telling me, "Yeah, you're good, you're good." It's like, yeah, but why didn't nobody pick me up then? And I couldn't understand it because it was always about how it was for us, nurtured into us. You were seen by scouts.
Mm.
So I was saying, well, if I'm that good, why ain't scouts seen me? What's going on? So I just thought I wasn't good enough. But when coming out, I went, joined the local side because I used to commute all the way from Slough down to London. And because my team, that was Hanwell Celtic at the time, played for him in school times. The manager there, Bristol Salt, rest in peace, called him Dish. He looked after us all, us kids. He used to pick us up, and when we was in trouble, even if we was in prison, well, say police station, he'd pick us up like a five figure. So I was just wanted to play for him, and but it was a bit too far till I got to a side which was Hindon Borough, where it started it all. Young 16 because I was in Borstal and I wrote a letter to the manager that I knew, Colin Barnes, and it's funny because I was like good behaviour and I came out, and as I was coming out he was coming down to collect me or to vouch for me, you know what I mean, but I'd already come out. So he said, "Look, come down Hindon Borough," and there was a good side. There was a summer league at the time, but I was in the youth, and I only played for the youth once. Next thing I know I was in the first team. He had a lot of stick, really, because I come out and I was straight into the youth playing, and the parents were making a right rampage.
Really?
Why is this guy coming? He said, "Look, man, he's a good player. And let me tell you something, he ain't going nowhere. If you don't like it, you can go." Well, he didn't say it like that. He said, "You fuck off." But,
You centre back first.
Hey?
We centre back first.
You know what? At school, trust me, I started centre half. And let me tell you something. I used to be like one of them road runners. I used to leave the centre. I used to strike. I said, "Look, go on, because I'll catch you." And it was like that. I was just, yeah, that quick. It was just amazing. I was just picking up balls. But what it was for me, when I had the ball at the back, I couldn't find nobody to pass to. So then I'd start to dribble right from centre half all the way down. And that's when they changed. I said, "Man, a man who could dribble like that, you need to be in their own half, their half, to do that damage."
Yeah.
So, yeah, I got moved to left wing. Started from there.
And how long was it before Chelsea picked you up from Hillingdon?
Well, got to say, it was a few terms, because I've got to say I was honoured to be playing for Hillingdon. I learned a lot. I can't remember the manager there, Bradford or somebody. And the ex-players that were like retired from pro and coming down, you know, in the league and so forth, they gave me so much encouragement. having my first pair of real proper boots, Puma, I think it was Puma Kings.
Nice.
And like, trust me, I was like, you don't know. And I keep telling these boys about Winfield boots. What Winfield? That was Woolworths, man.
Yeah.
Those boots were the toughest boots going, but ugly, but I had to clean them. Because my mum would never make me play football if I didn't clean her boots, because that's what her big money bought, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but yeah, the guy, he called me and said, look, meet me on a Thursday. And I went, Thursday where? Sports Centre. And if anybody remembers, Steve Perriman had the Sports Centre down in Uxbridge, I think it was. And I went down, met him down, and he told me to choose a pair of boots. And I thought, God, he's paying for boots. So I'm picking the cheapest pair of boots. And he said, Candice, what are you doing? Well, he didn't call me Candice. Candice, what are you doing? I'm picking the boots. He said, I said, pick yourself a decent pair of boots. And that's where I got the Puma King.
Yeah, straight on that.
Wow.
Good show.
The level on that was unbelievable.
So far, it seems like every what you really needed to kick on for your youth, just this is on this snapshot of hearing it, is the moments where you got encouragement or people saying, yeah, you're good, and that belief in yourself, or someone's believing in you to buy you a pair of boots or whatever it might be. Is that that point where you kind of things kicked on for you? It's just an interesting thing. And when you talk about being a kid and perhaps your parents weren't around in the way that you necessarily needed them, they weren't, but it's interesting that though that encouragement that you didn't get from home came from other people when you least expected it. So, Chelsea, we have to move on because people are saying, "What are you going to talk about Chelsea?" But the, you paid, I don't know, somewhere between 80 and 100 games for Chelsea.
Yeah.
All right. But you're probably one of the most important players that they've ever had for reasons other than what people might expect. Do you want to, instead of me explaining it, what?
I keep hearing this in important and how I paved the way or legend and so forth. And it wasn't about that. The dream, age of 5, wanted to be a professional footballer. Didn't think he had the chance. Once again, mentioned encouragement. Didn't think he got that, and it was other people telling you that until I was at Hillingdon and had chances and trials, Southampton, West Brom, Wimbledon, and Chelsea came in. Ron Stewart, the scout at the time. And I went for trials my first week, and it was like, wow, I'm next to these pros, and I've just been watching them on telly, and I'm standing next to them. You don't know, this kid's like, whoa. This is nerves, man. Mickey Joy, look at this giant, man. Whoa. So you can imagine a kid like, I was 19, and suddenly I'm thinking, wow, you know what? This is a chance. Don't mess it up. And like, when I was getting the ball, man, I wasn't doing what I normally do, I naturally do. I just kept the ball and gave it back. I just gave it back because they couldn't say I did anything wrong. I didn't lose it. I gave it back.
Yeah.
So I was doing that regular. I'm like thinking, yeah, did a bit, played in the reserve game and so forth. And the week there, thought, well, somebody's going to talk to me, say something. But nobody says nothing. And I went, well, that's kind of weird. Well, how do you know, do you get on? What did I do?
Yeah.
And nobody said nothing. And pardon me, I just went back to the club, Hindon Borough, thinking, well, that was it. That was my chance. I'm not good enough, Paul. And it's funny that the guy came back. He said, what's wrong? I said, what's wrong? Nobody said nothing. I said, no, we're interested, man. Come back again. I went, what? And I thought, well, you know what? I'm not doing nothing. I'm doing the same thing. Just pass it back, Paul. Don't do it wrong. And I tell you, the person who started me, who really, once again, encouraged, Graham Wilkins. Ray Wilkins' brother. He was right back. And he stopped me. He said, look, Ken. I said, they don't want to see that. He said, take me on. And I'm giving it like, you sure? And I mean, he don't know. If I take him on, I'll make him look silly. But like, and I said, go on, yes, take me on. And it's like, boy, my flow started to come back and I dropped the shoulder and I'm going, woof, gone. And I was like, oh gosh, this is easy. And I dropped in, I was doing, supplying the ball, crossing the ball, crossing the ball. And all week, it was that confidence was building up. And then Friday come in, the nerve wrack, and you're seeing the manager, and they said, yeah, can Johnny Owen see you? And I'm thinking, shit, this is it, man. Shit, did I do enough? Did I do all right? Trust me, you can imagine. You're outside the door, and I'm like, just God. And I'm going over what I think I did right, and what I think, oh, I could have done better there. And I'm thinking, did he see that? Shit, I don't know. And I'm going in and going in the office, aye. This is my Welsh accent. Aye, lad. Aye. And he said, we like what you do. And we're going to assign you to the end of the season. And that was about 7 months in that season.
Yeah.
And I've had to prove to get a contract.
Mm.
And when he said it, yeah, we're going to sign you. You don't know, man. I literally, playing all calm and cool until I got outside. Fucking, I went, I made that the loudest shout. The noise I let up, come on. And I said, yeah. And the people come out, is everything all right? Yeah, 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 yeah. And trust me, it was like phone my sister, phone
yeah,
people,
first,
you know.
Yeah,
who the oh, my sister,
talk?
Man.
Yeah.
Yeah, big time. Big
What's
time.
What's that phone call like?
That phone with my sister is always cool, but it's like, yeah, go and tell mum. Yeah, really? You tell mum. No, you tell mum. And my mum, so she just like, hi mum. What? No. You know what I mean? She always think there's something wrong when your phone. And said, yeah, guess what? What? Mum, man, I've done it. Done what? Yeah, I've done it. Done what?
Stolen the Twix.
I'm probably, yeah. I'm a professional, I'm signing up. But you know when I thought I could hear something, so what? It was like, wow.
Oh.
All right, cool, bye. You know what I mean? I wanted to hear that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I proved.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? All the troubles I gave you, the troubles I've been in, you're like, I've done it. Come on, man. But she didn't give me that encouragement.
Yeah.
So for me, it was a fight for myself.
Did she look retrospectively at that and recognize what you did achieve? Or was it something she couldn't get her head around?
You know what? Mum was proud of me, but didn't show it. She wasn't my person to show it.
Yeah.
So it was like, nothing failed, but it's like, to share that, it would have been something weak for her. Because they were brought up discipline. That's how she is. I've been to the Caribbean, I've been to St. Martin, and they bring up those kids very hard.
Mm.
But for mum to show that emotion, she didn't show it. And that's probably what we wanted from my sister and myself.
Mm.
Yeah.
That encouragement, that love, and said, well done, then. Yeah, come on, you can prove yourself, you see where you've come, see how far you've come. She didn't give us that.
Mm.
So I had to do this all myself. I don't know, and when I talked, it was like nice to share something, but it's like, when I shared it, it was like, wasn't the person I wanted to share it with.
Yeah.
So and I wasn't openly, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, as much as they said, well done, Paul, it wasn't that I wanted to hear from them.
Yeah,
I wanted
course.
To hear from.
Yeah, yeah.
But,
To put it into perspective, that story on its own of going from Hillingdon to getting into the Chelsea first team, which we're going to get into in a sec, but the squads, they're not the squads that Chelsea have now. There's not 50 players and 60 players out on loan, is there? There was like, I mean, there's one sub. There's
it.
How many in your squad? How many do you have in the squad at Chelsea?
No, let me tell you something. It's funny because we were talking about this the other day, and I talking about on under the bridge when I did hospitality, we were on stage and we do a short little Q&A. It was me, Colin Pates, and John Hollins, my manager. And it was like, do you remember, Pacey? It wasn't like 11 players and you're having about 6 substitutes. It was just one substitute, 11 players, and that manager had to use his months of when to pull you on.
That was
not
nice.
Too early, not too late. It's to make a difference because you can get an injury. You're supposed to replace that. If you've got another injury, where do you go?
Mm.
So this is what I kept telling these youngsters, man. And when I did get on, it was like, for me, to make an impact. As much as I always wanted to start off the game, I thought, God, man, I've got to make an impact. And if I change the game, all the best. That's good for me, and hopefully that'll get me into the side. But yeah, it was difficult back then. I came at a time when the boys, the team, weren't playing too well and they was low in the league. I think it was third from the bottom, fourth at one time. And I came at a period where, you know what I mean, they all had their favourite players, the Clive Walker, the Floyd Drivers, the Mickey Feelers, Pace, Mickey Joy. And young black boy, don't get me wrong, I just got on with the youth. And I just, to be honest, I thought it was easy. Because I was playing in reserves and I thought, God, this should be hard. No, I was scoring goals left, right and centre. And obviously making a difference and making a nuisance, to be honest, because the manager just got me in. It was out of the blue. And yeah, the debut.
Did you know what kind of club Chelsea were when you signed? You have any idea about what their fan base was made up of? I mean, it's weird actually that you're a fan of Leeds and Chelsea, because not only are they rivals, they're actually rivals in how potentially racist their fans could have been at the time.
I had no idea.
You know, and also, this was, they had a big Combat 18 movement at the time, which is neo-Nazism, essentially.
I had no idea. I was coming there. I probably didn't see that at the first 3 months, to be honest, because I wasn't in the first team, so it was obviously reserve football, and reserve football was played in the week. So there was no lesson. You just come in the week, play in the afternoon, and you've gone home until Saturday. And boy, it was like, the kick home, I think, was the debut. And then after that, it was like the home game. It's like this march and this group, and they're not the normal fan. They've got some serious boots and training. I was like, whoa. And I realized, this is National Front. How do you get these supporters? And, well, it was frightening sometimes because I didn't want to be recognised. I had the cap or something like this, walking down, kept down, and brochures being put in front of me, and I said, can't you see, mate? I'm black. Like, and
you mean when you're walking down the street, you had a cap on?
Yeah, I had a cap on. I was outside the ground, and literally, because we only had the first entrance, didn't we? Right now, you've got the two entrances now, but it was only the one entrance so far. And you used to walk them past there. It was kind of scary because they were lined up there, and you're walking past, and like I'm trying to pretend I'm not going to the ground, kind of thing. I've got nothing connected to the ground, but until I got to the entrance, got in there quick.
That's mad as a player,
man. That was scary.
Yeah.
So for your debut itself, you were on the subs bench when you came. Yeah. On, obviously, and you were completely oblivious to that experience. So explain that experience for people who don't know what you were.
That it was. Your excitement, the young boy's excitement, he's called in, you're going to be sub. You knew from early in the day, I think it was. Because I had to go and get my mum to bring my suit. You know what I mean? And I said, my gosh, and like, yeah. On the coach, it was a journey thinking, oh my God, if I get on, I get on. And you're talking the game, you're talking for the game, and you don't even know if you've got on. So, there I was, and you start to see the crowd come in, think, God, this is, this is where you want to be. So
you feel at home in that atmosphere.
It was good.
So many people.
You're nervous because right now these guys have come to see you play football, and you got to put off performance. You got to play as a team and so forth. But my teammates were so supportive. Don't get me wrong, and that was the great thing about it. These guys that played regular and said, "Candice, when you get on, do the best, mate. Just hold the ball, take your time." So they encouraged me, you know. And I was come outside, and I saw my supporters, and I saw all their supporters, and I thought, oh, yeah. And sitting down, did the warm up, and just sit down, and the whistle started, thinking, yes. And then you just take in, because you have to take in your opponent, because I'm playing a position with left wing, so it's right back. And I'm looking at right back, and I said, oh gosh, he is so slow. So slow. I'm going to roast this guy. You know what I mean? I know I'm going to roast him. And you're just waiting for that time. And if the team's playing well, then don't worry. Go with it, but if they're not, come on, man, let's change it. And it was going 0-0 right through the first half. And I thought, yeah, if it's 0-0, I'm not gonna get on the chain. And I was waiting. You could have been 15 minutes, went 20 minutes, went 25. I think, wait, this man ain't watching what? I'm not contained. I'm talking to myself, I'm on the line, I'm making hell noises, like, to mind the man I'm
manager in front of him. Just
seriously, could you imagine where you had aluminium studs? You know what I mean? I'm making the hell noise. Just to make sure he knows I'm here still. Like, what's happening, man? Just get me on. And like, you can't tell the manager to, you know what I mean? I'm right, and this is how it was. As close as you are to me, I'm like, yeah, man. The chair was moving, yeah. And I'm thinking, come on, man, and it's like...
Because it's literally just you and him, isn't it?
It's me, and him, yeah. It was just...
In hindsight, you think that maybe that cost you a few minutes?
Seriously, about three people right there. I'm thinking, come on, you can see the game as well as I can. Change this. But like, and I've seen the time, and it's like, wow, 10 minutes. What is it like? 10 minutes. And his dad tells me, go and get warmed up. And you know, as a kid, you're thinking... You're not even thinking that. You think, go and get warmed up. What, for 10 minutes? I was like that. I was really giving action, like, and wanted to tell him, what, for 10? And realised where I was. I went, he's the manager, Paul, hold on. Yeah. Let's get up here. And so I went down the line, and I warmed up, and I started warming up, and boy, trust me, I had my back. And I thought, yeah, this is good. Just stretch it, because I'm going to hurry up and get onto the pitch. boy, that would have hit. Because I started hearing this abuse, and I thought, wow, I didn't know Crystal Palace were like that. Whoa, they're really trying to put me off, and I ain't even on there. And it was scary, because they're like, oi, you nigger, sit down. I wasn't, nah, mate, I ain't even looking. Oi, you black. No. And it was that near, because you know how it was them times in Sterling. It was that cold, the crowd was closer to you in the warm-up. And so I could feel it, the vibe, I could feel it amongst you. And I said, oh, you nigger, go back home, you monkey. And I was like, nah, fuck this. And I turned around. And that was a shock, because when I turned around, I was like, what? That ain't Crystal Palace, man. That's, I had to look at it, good, that's Chelsea fans. And I was thinking, but I got a Chelsea shirt. Nah, that didn't make no change, no difference.
And you said to yourself, they're literally just there, the hit. Is that how it felt? You turn around and just like,
that was the
smack
hit
in your face. That, like, wow.
Just dropped every piece of confidence right at me. Knocked me for six. I literally was excited, young boy, ready to rip. Now, I'm just like, Canners? Yeah, I'm coming. And I don't even want to go on the pitch. Because I'm drained. I don't know what I'm going to do. So it was great. I went to the pitch and I did what I did at the start. When I started, at the start, I got the ball, I gave it back. I couldn't find no energy to go and take on and do what I did because I was shocked. So I just waiting for the referee to blow his whistle.
Get back in. Did you talk to anyone about it?
No. I'll tell you what, I remember this just by...
Did your teammates, was it clear shocked that they were aware of it?
They was weird, they heard it. And when I went in, I ran straight in and they saw me in the corner. It wasn't asked, what were you gonna ask me? Poor, you all right? They could see I wasn't all right. And I was like, whoa, I just wanted to get out of here and go.
Yeah. You didn't hold any kind of anger towards them?
Oh, no,
there's not
no
much they can do, is
it? It wasn't them. I know that. And they could see, I know this in effect. I saw them, they was like, fucking, what did you go through? And it was like, wow. And it was no, faintly, you can hear it. And you can hear the anger from their supporters at that time. So it for that, it did drain me. I had lost everything from me that wanted to perform was gone.
And we were chatting about right at the start, you're saying, what is that thing that you've learned? And you're talking about encouragement. It seems to be a bit of a theme we're kind of going through. But so leading up to that game, it sounds like your teammates had supported you and built you up and you'd flourished with that. And then in that second, it's then drained away when you see that lack of support from the supporters.
Yeah.
What was the game like after that? How do you pick yourself up and go again? What was going through your mind the next time you came on? Because did it happen again straight away?
Yeah, of course.
Always.
It did, man.
Yeah.
It was happening away, happening at home.
So how do you keep coming back and keep going again?
You got to understand this, because how I got home, I don't remember how I got home, if I got a lift, because I was living in Slough at the time. And I had family, friends that were there, and they were hurt as more than what I was, kind of thing, and disgusted, should I say, and telling me, boy, why do you want to play here? Leave the club. They're racist. But I had to explain, it wasn't the club that racist, just some fans are. Yeah, but what fan would do that to your own player? No, man, don't stay here, Paul, you're mad. And I was like, fuck that. I've been given an opportunity here. And it's not easy. So what happens if I leave here to go where? And if I go, it happens there. What happened then? It was kind of, you know what? Going back, obviously, to what my mum was talking to me about, what she had to do when she was at work, and I was saying, you know what? Nah, man, I'm going to have to turn the face. As much as I get angry, and I do get angry quickly, but right now, I don't want to give anybody a reason to throw me out. This is my dream, this is my chance. So I literally had to take it. Don't get me wrong, I was peeing, I was like, that kind of grin, but it wasn't a grin. It was like...
You know what, because it depends how you reacted then would have defined the impact that you eventually had. And like you said, how important it was that you did play for Chelsea. Because there were other black players that played. Water Toll played for Tottenham.
Yeah.
In, I think, 19...
Is it the 60s? Yeah.
1916? Before the First World War.
Yeah.
But you was at Chelsea, which did have a kind of racist element to their support. And we should say not all of them. You know, it wasn't like the whole crowd were yeah. baying for your blood or anything. But you made it acceptable somewhat, and it shouldn't have come to that, but it was the way it was, where black players could readily play for Chelsea, and you went back there later, didn't you? And to find,
after obviously coming from that ladder and coming down, life did kind of spiral, and I was depressed because coming out of the game early, I went back after I was invited, to be honest, from Chelsea, and there I was working with the education department and going into schools. That was the first thing, I was sharing my story, and it was like thinking, sharing your story to these kids who weren't even born when you was playing, how are they going to know me? But yes, they knew the history, the white, what's now stays as Wikipedia, like yeah. history. It was like, well, but yeah, coming back at Chelsea, I was kind of, well, yeah, Cannon's come for this game, we're playing Man City, and I'd love you to come on the pitch, you know what I mean? I went, well, I said, okay. And I was there, and it was like, you know what, you can imagine, the night before, I was so nervous, and I was like going through it. I was looking at it, said, Paul, what if the people don't like you? Man, you've been away and ain't got that black people. I'm thinking, nah, man, I can't take that abuse again. I'm not even a player. And I was going through a lot of things, dreaming at night. And then got up in the morning, I got early thinking, yeah, get myself ready, get the smart casual and thing. I think, God, I'm down the ground. And I'm on the train, and you can see the fans out on the train, and none of them recognize me, and I'm keeping it low. And the boys, you know what I mean, that are seeing me. And I'm thinking, yeah, watch out, will he recognize me? But cool. I got the ground, I saw Neil, I said, yeah, Dom Ryan, there's a seat up there, what's going on? I'm going to call you half time. I said, yeah, and I'm watching. I'm thinking, shit, boy, what happened here? Because this ain't the Bridge of old. This is all gone. I mean, the shed in, that stone's gone, it's all seated. I'm like, what happened here? The track that was around it, it's all gone. I'm thinking, wow, when did they do this? How long have I been away? And it was like, sat down there and half time, I think it was 0-0, and then half time I'm thinking, shit, he's calling me on, and I got escorted Mr. Cannibal, and I got down to it, and I'm thinking, oh my God, went through the tunnel, and you can imagine, I'm looking the first thing from my manager's office, and it ain't there no more, and I'm seeing it's up to date. I think, what the fuck is this? Damn. So I was in the media room, can I see you? You're Cannibal, aren't you? I said, yeah. Who the arse is he? You know what I mean? It was so different. I've never seen the media room. It was like, the reporters all over there tipping away, and I was like, what is this? And then Neil was coming in, just going, then what I'm going to do, I'm going to talk a bit, and I'm going to introduce you, just come in the picture and so forth. I said, okay. And I was at the side, I'm not lying, I was just like this, in front, I don't know. And he walked down the steps, and you know, I said, damn. And then Neil makes the introduction, and the player that you would know, he came on Sheffield Wednesday, scored a goal, and I thought, well, they should know me by then. And our first black player, I was like, oh my God. I listened to that, and I went out, Paul Cannavale, and I went out, and I was like quarter of a way onto the green. And damn, it was like, I started to hear applause. And I was like, fuck off. You know what I mean? Like, what's wrong with these guys? Do they remember me? Fuck. You know what I mean? And then people standing up, and like, and I'm trying not. You know that one where you're not trying to stare, but you want to stare to make sure, like, so nobody's like turning the head and like.
Take.
And yeah, Paul Cannavale, and I thought I'd just go on and come off. He's like, so I gave it that one, and I turned all around and said, thank you very much. And Neil's only said, yep, let's walk around. Are you fucking sure? He said, East End, Paul Cannavale. I said, oh my God. And I'm walking. I swear you not.
Yeah.
I had tears in my eyes. I was so emotional, and my legs were shaking. I've never come out. I started shaking. I'm thinking, I just wanted to hear that outburst. Nigga, I wasn't hearing it. Everybody, Cannavale, was coming. I went to the West, Matthew Harding went to the West. I could not be even the shed. I was like, damn. And it was like so emotional.
It sounds like it was a really cathartic moment for you. Is it something that, therefore, if it was cathartic, that must have been, that was something that you'd held in yeah. you for what's that, that 15 years or
yeah,
whatever
it was? I mean, you could say I'm retired from 86 and here we are 2004, and not knowing how I'd be approached or received, should I say, and it was like, wow, coming back Chelsea, didn't think I would, and to see the changes and to be accepted, and it was like, not accepted, it was like they remembered.
Mm.
And they remembered obviously what you went through, and I mean the whole ground, I was like, wow, I really did not expect that.
A different kind of hit,
man. That was trying to, yeah, I know where the hit you mean, but anyway, it was a different buzz altogether. When I went back to sit down and the temperature, well, I mate, with that thing, so like, pull. And then when I saw it, it's like, wow, not taking in the game, but realised we were like 7 black players here. Drogba, Mazzola, I said, what the? 7, what's going on? And that's when the guy just sat me, he said, yeah, Candace, mate, you started this. I said, what? He said, you made this happen. All these black players are here in Chelsea. And I heard that. I didn't take it in so seriously, but I heard that, and it's like, it kind of flowed, because I kept hearing it now, and I had to believe, you know, fair enough, you know what I mean? But, yeah, it is, every time I go there, like, I get bumps, I do. I still get nervous, even when I do my, like, hospitality, I still get nervous. But
yeah, because it kind of becomes intrinsically a part, it's sewn into you, when
yeah.
you suffer such a traumatic experience.
I do, and the guys, they're supporting, I still get frightened, like, Canners!
Yeah.
When I mate, you're all right. Yeah. Can I get a picture? I'm like, bloody hell.
Yeah.
She's different.
Have you ever had a fan come up to you, a Chelsea fan come up to you who'd said something that they now regret?
Yeah. I've had.
What's that like?
That was the early stages when we was at, in the Champions League, playing like the Barcelona and all that. And this particular game, this Champions League, I was thinking, well, this is different league. I've never seen the Champions League foreign teams coming across to the bridge. So obviously this is where the stage where it's different for me, that I was walking and it was like, Kenners. I said, look, mate, I said, yeah, thank you. He said, look, I want to apologise. And I went, for what? I don't know you. Why? Look, I was one of those guys that racially abused you. And I was like,
what, he's an old boy?
Yeah. I don't know, my boy's had his kid. I was like, what do I do here?
Yeah.
And I was like, mate, that's done and dusted. No, Kenneth, I need to apologise. I'm going to be honest, I'll tell you, I didn't know what I was doing. I was just following my old man.
Mm-hmm.
When I was a kid thinking, because he told me, yeah, the black boys, and I was just following him. I didn't know no better. But I make sure now my kids, they understand what it is, the effect it means, racism. And I said, well, mate, you just told me that that's the best way. I'm cool with that.
Mm.
And I got that many times, it's like, wow. To even, I thought that for them, for me, brave, you didn't have to come to me and let me know that you was one of those people that racially abused me. No.
No, you could have
just
stopped.
Left it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have known no better.
And I guess to a point, it's almost the opposite of what you went through in 2004 when you've gone there and you need that moment maybe just to experience it again. I guess that's a lesson in life as well, that when things are a little bit scary, sometimes you just got to step out and go through it. You know,
that's the one.
So obviously before, I mean, we kind of flipped about in timescale then, but I just want to quickly touch on your injury at Reading, because it was horrendous, wasn't it? You moved to Reading, you had your career at Chelsea, then you moved, dropped down a division to play at Reading, a kind of new start without the kind of pressure of that kind of stuff.
Mm.
You had that process, you had a great game against Sheffield Wednesday when coming off the bench, I think at halftime.
Yes.
3-0 down.
4-3, 4-all.
4-all, you scored 2 goals.
Yeah, change it up, but...
But then you went on to Reading.
Yes.
And didn't play for very long, was it 12, 15?
First season.
Right,
in the first season, and I think, to be honest, if I was playing, they would have got promoted. We started to change the football. I've got to give Ian Bramford enough respect for giving me the chance and believing in me. A nice bunch of players.
Mm.
And like you just said before, it was a lot more relaxed. It wasn't too much pressure like it was in that first division with Chelsea. Here I was, they got promoted in second division, and they were just, this is not too difficult. Nobody flashed or nobody, I just got on.
Mm.
And obviously I was a big baller for them coming from Chelsea to them, and, you know what I mean? But the football was not, not in the league, guys. This football with the long ball and chase, and I had to say, what is going on here? You know what I mean? So I had to talk to the man and say, look, if you want the best out of me, give him the ball to my feet.
Mm.
So we changed it. Stuart Bev was in midfield, Steve Richardson that was behind me, and we just started to play football. And we were getting results, and I was just playing Trevor Senior, and he was just anything he hit was going in goal.
Mm.
And we had Terry Urlock. Oh, man.
Forget. What's your best Terry Urlock story?
My best.
He's a nut, isn't he?
Getting the welcome from that boy. It's funny like because I just wanted to play football.
For people a bit younger, can you, I guess, first explain who Terry Urlock is?
Well, all right. You don't know Terry. Terry Urlock is a gypsy. No disrespect to gypsy. Yeah? Trust me, long hair, big balded, fit. Trust me, frightening. But I was leaving Chelsea after what was happening, and I went to Brentford. And I was just about to sign, I think Frank McClintock was the manager there. And he went away to the chairman after agreeing on signing on and whatever. That I got the phone call, and Ian Bradford got me down there. I've got to tell you this whole story. He said, don't sign, but he's just gone, don't sign, I'm on my way. And he must have been on his way already because he was there in about 10, 15 minutes. So he's coming here, come on, drive him out. Hey, what, you're staying by my house. We go to training, take you to training in the morning. I went, okay, but I never came prepared. I already had my training gear and boots. So I saw this house, thinking this manager's out, thinking, yeah, money here. All right. So 2-2, I'm in bed, a great sleep. Got up. First thing you do, going for the tourney. So I've opened the doors. And as I open the doors, two girls, white girls, are in front of me. And as I opened the door, they started screaming. And I was like, oh shit. And like, first thing to me, because you're black, and two white girls are screaming, and I'm like,
yeah, yeah.
I'm like, shit, I ain't done nothing. Oh, I ain't done nothing, kind of thing. And Brentford come in, they said, well, boy, he's one of our players. They've never seen a black player, that person. I was like, what? I was like, what have I come to now? I don't think, you can imagine that. You hear that, and you're thinking, I just left Chelsea, just shit there, and this is what I'm coming. Oh, my
screaming
God.
Little white girl.
So I turned to anyway, got through that, bam, down to Elm Park training. And I got in there in the centre circle, and boy, them boys couldn't even take the ball off me. I was doing nuts, sent it. Anyway, we had a little 5-a-side possession, and then the person came in late, but I didn't ignore that, it just came in anyway. So I was just receiving the ball, and as I received the ball, bam, I was up in the air. I mean, up in the air. Hold on. I know we all know we're teammates, but that tackle, fucking, who is that? What the fuck you think you're doing? Because I was down on the floor and turned around, who the fuck? And it was like, I saw it was Stevie Richard, and he said, yeah, Cannon's, that's Terry Urlock. Now, I already heard rumour. I didn't even have seen this man, but you heard about Terry Urlock. Nice to meet you, Terry. Shake the man's hand. Trust me, I weren't even going in there. Let me tell you something, boy. This brother would change the game for you. There was trouble, man. Terry, you need to sort that guy. He's the playmaker. Terry would sort. Tackle and ball. In another minute, tackle and ball. He was like, oh, bam, bam. And when we started playing football, we were starting climbing up. Well, I think we were climbing third in the league. And unfortunately, that's when we played Sunderland away, and I got that injury, and it's like, yeah, changed.
What, it was a cruciate?
I dislocated cruciates and ligaments.
You dislocated your knee?
Dislocated.
And snapped your cruciate
ligaments.
Ligaments. Which in the modern era means a year out, at least.
Modern era is one of the worst injuries.
Yeah, some players do come back from it. I think Nistelrooy had the double cruciate and came back.
Yeah, QPR had a player that's sort of 3 years on the trot, but wow. back then it was.
And Reading well, up then look, there
you wouldn't have specialists back then as have they to the specialists they have now.
Yeah.
And for Reading it was a case of they took me the specialist that was there. I remember I was in the hospital at Sunderland, and got my mum down and my sister down. And they flew me back to Heathrow. Because imagine when I was in plaster, I had the whole plane. I couldn't believe it, the whole plane, you know. And my leg was across, couldn't even tie a seatbelt. My leg was across with the thing. I was like, oh my God, this whole plane. I'm thinking, wow, I don't think a club can do that. You know what I mean?
When the injury itself happened, did you think?
No.
Did you think it was bad,
thought,
or you thought it was going
to
be
get
okay?
Back to him. Yeah, of course. You don't think, because I didn't know the injury until the doctor. Don't get me wrong. It was like, it was painstaking when I was on my way to the hospital, and I still didn't realize what was going on. I was like, because it was all right. I was in shock. And I probably didn't know what was wrong. And I was on the ground thinking, yeah, dirty bastard.
Mm.
And yeah, wait till I get up. I'm going to brought some skill on this boy. And I'm thinking, I'm on the floor, I'm on the ball, I'm like, yeah, trying to. And I'm just being held down. And I've not even noticed the leg. I'm just being, what's wrong with you? Come on, man, let's take it. No, Paul, just cool. What, you mad? Let's go. He said, no, Paul, just be cool. And that's when you look at your leg and you see that your bottom half is one side turned and the other one's the other side, and like, what the fuck?
Oh, my
God. It was like that, and like, I'm like, what the fuck? And ambulance, stretchers come on, rushing the hospital, and now the pain's setting. And I mean, some serious, it was from, I'm turning back, cut this fucker off here, I couldn't take it. It was like, boom, boom, boom. And not knowing at the time until later on, they said how the knee had trapped the nerve. So the blood couldn't go through it. It was like trapped. And that was from, I'm in hospital pain. They can't deny I'm fucking dying. Get a doctor, get a nurse, fuck it, man, take it off. I swear, though, I must have been loose there. I just didn't know what I was saying. MS knocked me out. Next thing I woke up, I was in a cast. And I thought, yeah, cast all the way up there and there, thinking, oh, I must have broke my leg. And that was true. I thought I'd broken my leg.
It's much worse.
And I thought, yeah, well, if it's broken leg, you can get back to that. It's healed and you get back. So right away, I'm just waiting for the doctor. Yes, doc. How long have I got? And I just noticed the face. Mr. Cannibal. And I hate when they do that. When they go by the same name. Mr. Cannibal. That's serious. Let's call me Paul, but no, you call him Mr. Cannibal shit. You know what I mean? And he said, look, you've had one of the worst injuries in football. And I went, what? So what do you... So that you've dislocated, you've torn your crucifix, and you've torn your ligament. Yeah, I'm thinking, what do you mean? Come on, man, that can heal. He said, no, I'm going to be honest, it'd be very difficult for you to come back. I mean, nah, man, you can't believe me now. Nah, I still couldn't believe now. Nah, come on, man. Rehabilitation, we'll get back to this, man. We'll build up the leg. But then thoughts in my head, boy, started going and thinking, well, if I can't play football, what am I going to do? Because that's all I know.
Yeah.
That's all I know. I'm playing nothing else. So I was like, damn. Things started going in my head, and then it was like, shit, all that time my mum was telling me about taking my education serious now. Shit, why didn't I? Because now I don't know if I don't play football. Or, and it was like, I'm trying to think, no, there's no way I can't. I'm going to play football. I've got to play football. So, yeah, it's going back, specialist, seeing it, and then starting your at the ground. It was like, you had to heal first, so it's like about a good 6 months. I'm in like this cast, I'm not even lying. Even when I had to leave, I wanted to leave the hospital because I couldn't take it anymore. This is the only way you could leave this hospital is if you could show me that you can walk on walking sticks. I said, oh, that's easy. That's not no trouble. Come on, man, just give me the walking sticks, man. I'll do that. Let me tell you something. When you're on your bed for that long, your blood, yeah, is here. It's because you're sitting up like that. Now, my cast is up. I put the cast down to the ground. And now the blood went straight. Come from my head straight now. And the whole weight... I didn't know how heavy this cast was. It took me, I nearly had my head butted the mirror right in the sink, I swear, Lord. And like, I was dizzy and I was like, what is this? So he said, take your time. And then the nurse said, take your time, take your time. I said, bloody hell. I was like, so lightheaded, I was like, damn. And I just want to prove that I can walk out. It's not easy.
Yeah.
It's like a baby learning how to walk. I had to use these sticks to lift the leg that had no strength. Up a step at a time using your arm, and this is the arm. I swear, my God. But I thought that, and I said, look, man, I came out, and it was like, this is where I realized this is not going to be the same, Paul.
Mm.
So it's going to be long.
Do you know what? We're going to end it there. For two reasons. One, there's shitloads more to talk about. There's like fucking tons yeah, to talk about. But there's a book and the car's coming. So,
Oh, shit.
So Black and Blue, I'm not going to read the subline because I don't want to even spoil it. It was a winner of the British Sports Book of the Year. And it's an incredible, incredible read. Two of my friends, I spoke about you coming on this podcast, and I didn't even know that they knew who he was, and they said, I read his book. It's incredible. So go out and get that. You can get it at all good bookstores. There's honestly so much more.
Oh, yeah.
Because you was about to ask a question.
Sorry.
No, it's great. Because, I mean, that stuff's fascinating, but there's tons of stuff.
Can I ask one more question?
No. Go on, one more. Then.
Okay.
But how big of a reveal? Because people are going to want
to... It's not too bad.
All right.
Okay. Right. The one question I just desperately do want to ask is that, and it leads on from what you've just been through there, talking about the injury, and this is another reason to go and read the book, because I'm sure it obviously goes into all of that. But at the moment, there's people like... You've been through so much in your life, and that is just one... Having to finish your career at 25 is just one of those incredible things that you've had to go through, and you're on the other side of it now. There's someone that all English football fans love in Paul Gascoigne, and the only time we see him now is when he's going through the dark days that he's going through. And it's because he's struggled with that void of being defined a bit as a footballer, seeing that as your purpose, and struggling to get past that void. So my last question is, and I know, God, this is probably too big a question, but we started with something that you learned. I was wondering if we could finish with something that you've learned. One, could you just, if you can, briefly explain what that void feels like, and then what advice you would give to someone, an ex-player or someone like that, who's going through something like that? How can they get beyond that void?
When you notice it, because that's the hard thing, because you're in denial. That's the thing. You're telling yourself you don't need help. Yeah, you're telling yourself, no, I don't need help, and you're trying to hide from other people when they know you're in trouble, and people already know you're in trouble, but you're still in denial. Is to seek help. Don't be frightened about it, because there's many people. I'm not the only one. And don't get me wrong. We know the spiral I went to. I went for drugs. I went for cancer, and the drugs nearly took hold. It took hold of me. I'm not lying. It took control. I thought I was in control of it. I wasn't, and I was doing things I never thought I'd been doing. I was hurting a lot of people, and that was when I didn't know what to do, because I didn't want to let people know. I was embarrassed. I was ashamed. Yeah, well, I was a footballer, and now look, I'm a drug addict. How do I say that? How do you come from that? And sad things of my son dying in my arms, that opened, and my kids that I was doing in front of them, it was hurting. So then having cancer, diagnosed with that was, yeah, killer. I had to tell myself, I need to change. And it was like, I could get help from anybody, but you had to be ready for that help. I can say, you help me, and say, yeah, but I still can't do what I had to do. I had to say to myself, Paul, now I need the help. That's what it was. It was seeking that and going to it and not being afraid for somebody to put their hand on you and help you. Because I was strong-minded. I didn't like, begging or, anybody help me. It's not about that. You're on a road to destruction. And trust me, it would only get worse unless you seek the help. So please do, don't be frightened about it. I don't care if it's counselor. And that was the one thing I was feared of, not going to a counselor and talking about business. But that was the best thing for me. So, yeah.
And even that doesn't touch the side of what's in this book. It's incredible. Thank you so much, Paul.
Thanks, man.
Really kind to give us your time. And I hope that people go out there and read this book, because it is absolutely superb. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if you're Chelsea, Reading, Tottenham, whatever it is. It's an amazing book.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks so much. And remember, if you want to watch this, it's on the Long Ball Street YouTube channel. And that's it. Subscribe. Rate. James, thanks again.
It's just nice to be in the room. Nice to listen to you, Paul. Absolute pleasure.
Thanks a lot.
Cheers.